As I said, it's a very, very great pleasure and a privilege to be here. Just an aside with respect to Meta talking about role playing, what I've been doing for the last number of years, off and on, two or three times a year, has been work. It started out working with the UN, but then with NATO and some EU, but of late mainly NATO. It's working with essentially the force commander, so the commander of the military force, the NATO commander, and his senior staff. It's all his so far. I haven't had a female general yet. I've had a number of senior officers, but it's working with the commander and his staff in the context of what the UN would call a peacekeeping operation, but what NATO calls a stabilization or a crisis response operation. It's working with those commanders and their staff so that they better understand how the military is, what the role of the military is in support of the broader peace building effort. Because the military aspect, the security aspect is very important, but the name of the game is building the peace. And therefore, the generals often like to think they're in charge of everything, but really they are a support element in the overall endeavor. So it's trying to bring that, trying to explain and to promote cooperation between the various elements, particularly the civilian, political, diplomatic, and the military. And hence the role playing, the way the military trains, they have the money to do it. It's a wonderful way to train, and I've done it once with a civilian organization, is they simulate an actual mission. So you go away for whatever period of time it might be, 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, and you actually create an environment where you're in a mission that's never an exact place. It's always an amalgam of several different conflicts. And there's a whole lead up to a year before the actual deployment, just like there would be in real life, where the planning is done. And so throughout all of that, the civilian elements of the role play with expertise in political diplomatic affairs or human rights or development work with the military so that they come to understand where they fit in the overall puzzle. So that's it's very, very interesting, very, very challenging. I mean, by the time you get the generals, they're pretty dyed in the wool. I mean, I don't know how much, you know, you like to think you have some impact on some generals, but it's really their staff that you're, you know, the next generation that you're focusing on with a hope that when they get into some of these extraordinarily difficult situations, they will, you know, they'll think back to the kind of cooperation that's required. And, you know, really, the bottom line is when, you know, when push comes to shove, it's the military understanding that it is in support and not in the lead in the overall effort. I was going to talk more about that tonight, but I don't, well, we can get into it if there's interest in it. But this is one of the big distinct differences between UN-led peacekeeping operations and NATO operations, or EU for that matter. In the UN-led operation, it's a combined mission where there is a civilian head of the mission, reflecting the fact that essentially peace building is a political, diplomatic, humanitarian, socioeconomic exercise with a security element. The UN mission is led by a senior civilian. And then there are various support elements, including within the mission, including the force commander of the peacekeeping mission. In contrast with NATO, and this goes back essentially to the United States not wanting to be under UN command, there's a separate military mission. And this is very difficult and very challenging. And when I talk about this at length, I argue that this kind of effort of the international community to help a fragile state start to build a democracy is so difficult that you really have to have your lines of command and control worked out. And it's all very well to have the UN Security Council say that the NATO force will cooperate with the UN. When push comes to shove, if you're just relying on cooperation, if you don't have a leader, a head of the mission, a civilian head who can say that activity is not going to help us, it's not in support of what we're trying to do, then there are problems. So I'm a bit of a, in other contexts, I'm a bit of a proselytizer on the absolute fundamental importance of UN-led peacekeeping and the tragedy of Western professional militaries, the ones with the best forces, among the best, all opting out of, not all of them, but most of them, and certainly Canada, opting out of UN peacekeeping and focusing on NATO peacekeeping. And I think things might have been very, very different in Afghanistan if it had been a UN-led Blue Helmet mission with, this is, you know, after the sort of war fighting ouster of the Taliban phase, with the clear objective of building the peace and with an overall lead to coordinate. Okay, I've ended my little pitch on that. Now I'll get to what I said I was going to be talking about tonight, building peace in the 21st century, reflections over 30 years. That reminds me of Meta saying, well, how did you get to doing, well, I explained how I met Joe Clark. I mean, I suppose the first time I met him was because Maureen McTeer was a year behind me in law school. But I really, it was when I was advisor to the Canadian Advisory Council on the Status of Women, and the constitutional issue became so serious that I ended up going to work for him. But when I went to work for him, he was leader of the official opposition. Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition had a big staff. Then when the leadership of the party changed to Brian Mulroney, although Joe Clark as the former Prime Minister had a slightly bigger staff than the average MP, it's still drastically reduced. And instead of having many different advisors, he suddenly had one, a Jill of all trades, and that was me. And so I started working on many more things than legal issues. And in the course of that time, there was something that some of you might remember, the Trudeau Peace Initiative. Very bad time in the international, on the international front. The arms race was pretty well out of control, and there were no negotiations going on. This was 1983. And so Prime Minister Trudeau proposed this kind of fairly innovative initiative. And Joe Clark convinced Brian Mulroney, then leader of the official opposition, that this needed to be, in American terms, bipartisan, that all parties needed to support this endeavor. And that led to him being named the official spokesperson for arms control, disarmament, and international security matters. So I, as the Jill of all trades at that point, and of course lawyers always think, I guess some others think they can do everything, off I moved over, and of course foreign affairs is a generalist area anyway, there I moved over to that. And it was from that point, from this shadow peace initiative, working with Joe Clark, that I started really focusing on international security questions. Then when the government changed and Joe Clark became foreign minister, I came into his office on his so-called exempt political staff as a policy advisor on international security policy, with a particular focus on Canada-US, on NATO, and on the UN. That's the story of have, you know, in the very crass words of an American colleague at a luncheon at one point, oh, you went from broads to bombs, but there you have it. So, you know, a step up by anyone's measure. Or no, broads to bombs. Good heavens, I got it the wrong way around. Step down, clearly. I'll talk for a while, and then I know some of the, already know that there'll be good questions from some of the people here that I do know, because the question time is always interesting. But what I'm trying, you know, the title is Reflections. So I'm trying to go back over some of the things that I was involved in and make some observations about them. I've already started from my notes in telling you how I became a policy advisor to the Right Honorable Joe Clark. And I worked with him in that capacity as a policy advisor on international security issues from September of 1984 until mid-1989, although there was a short break, October, November, and December 84, when my son was born the end of October. But otherwise, in those 5 years, I dealt with all sorts of arms control and disarmament issues at the UN, where Stephen Lewis was our permanent representative. Interesting, that was one of the quite inspired appointments by a then progressive conservative government, appointing as our as a very, very senior position in the Foreign Service, a very important position, at least then for Canada. The UN was very important, was the permanent representative, so the most senior. There are a number of ambassadors to the UN. I mean, I was one of them, but I was in the area of disarmament ultimately. But Stephen Lewis was the overarching, if you will, permanent representative. And then he was followed by E. Forche, who was our permanent representative at the time that Canada was on the Security Council, during the time that that I was working in Joe Clark's office. That was also the time, in that period of time, 84 to 89, when another person that some of you here will know, the Honorable Doug Roach, who had previously been a Conservative MP but had been very dedicated to the disarmament cause, was Ambassador for Disarmament. During that time, I attended, I think I missed one, that was due to being home on maternity leave, of the NATO meetings of the North Atlantic Council, when it met at the foreign minister level. And I looked at issues, very hot topics at the time, like Canada's response to President Reagan's Strategic Defense Initiative, Star Wars as the press called it. I like to remind, we said no. Cruise missile testing over Alberta, we didn't say no. And nuclear powered submarines, again, another no. In August of 1989, after the departure of Ambassador Roach and on the recommendation of the Foreign Minister Joe Clark, I was appointed Canada's ambassador, and the title, the full title at the time, was to the UN, Ambassador to the UN for Arms Control and Disarmament. I just note here, I won't go into it, but if anybody's interested and remembers at the end of this, one of the fun sort of things, I guess, and this comes with a bilingual country, was when I was named Ambassador for Disarmament, the fight that broke out. I mean, it was a real serious issue, and it held up my cards for quite a while, between the Department of Foreign Affairs and the Office of Official Languages about the French translation of my title, Ambassador for Disarmament. Can anybody think of what that would be? What the fight would be over? It was whether it was ambassadeur or ambassadrice. Because of course, in the strict French, and it stayed ambassadeur in the end, official languages wins, and everybody in the end wanted that. The French title, you know, Madame le Président, they don't, you know, the strict ambassador, whether they're male or female, of course, when these rules were dreamed up, they were all male, and the real concern was that ambassadrice is the spouse of the ambassador. So, anyway, they resolved it in the end. So, I wonder if anyone here knows the origin of the job, that of this job of Ambassador for Disarmament, that Ambassador Doug Roach first held and in which I followed. And I think it's a story worth telling. It goes back to the first UN special session on disarmament. The UN periodically holds gatherings at either the level of foreign minister or head of government periodically on important topics. And this was the first UN special session, so a plenary session, but not a regular session, a special session on disarmament. It was called UNSOD 1, acronyms galore, of course, in the UN system, in 1978. In consultations prior to this conference being held, the interested Canadian public called for a dedicated disarmament ambassador at the UN who would be more accessible to the public and more clearly focused on arms control and disarmament issues than was the case for those ambassadors that we currently had in Geneva or Brussels or Vienna, where various security-related negotiations took place. Prime Minister Trudeau included in his statement to the General Assembly at UNSOD 1 the pledge to create this position, to name an ambassador for disarmament with this particular mandate. But for various reasons, which actually remain unknown to me, no action was taken on this pledge until the election campaign of 1984, when the then Liberal leader, well, Prime Minister for a short time, John Turner, was running against the head of the Progressive Conservative Party, Brian Mulroney. As John Turner had asked the celebrated Canadian diplomat, George Ignatieff, yes, the father of Michael Ignatieff, to develop the terms of reference, and had indicated that Ignatieff would be appointed, the father, not the son, if the Liberals were elected. As an aside, I note that Wikipedia says that the first diplomat to hold the position was George Ignatieff, but that's not true, and I keep forgetting to send a note into Wikipedia to tell them, yes, he developed the terms of reference, but because the election wasn't won by the Liberals, he actually was not appointed. The terms of reference, in my view, were really, really innovative and well worth considering here, especially, well, it was an insider, but thinking about a job that wasn't completely an inside job. There were three components: a negotiating role, a policy development role, and a public consultation role. So negotiating, policy development, and public consultation, all three of which reinforced and informed each other. And bear in mind, of course, at the time, there were really deep concerns about the nuclear arms race and about nuclear winter and about, you know, the end of the world. So this was something that the public was deeply engaged in and wanted some way of making their views and recommendations known to the government. So that was reflected, I think, in this, with the negotiating role, the policy development role, and a public consultation role, all three of which reinforced and informed each other. The negotiating role involved representing Canada in the UN's disarmament bodies, the First Committee and the United Nations Disarmament Commission, which are the two deliberative bodies, so-called, in New York, that look at these questions, disarmament and international security. But also, so that was New York. Then the Geneva end of it was representing Canada, heading Canada's delegation to the disarmament treaty reviews, because the Geneva Conference on Disarmament is where they negotiate the treaties. In New York, there's a lot of deliberation, developing of principles, raising awareness of issues, this is in the disarmament bodies, and trying to build common consensus for action, and then if there's an agreement to negotiate, it goes off to Geneva. And then if they successfully negotiate a treaty, as they did with the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, the Biological and Toxins Weapons Convention, and the Chemical Weapons Convention, all of these banning these weapons, then there were regular reviews in Geneva to see how the treaty was going. So that was also part of the job. The policy development role included the right to raise issues directly with the foreign minister when and if required. And my sister is in the Ontario Public Service and will recognize that it's a bit of a double-edged sword. Of course, you've got this power to leap over the deputy minister and go directly to the foreign minister, but you have to use it extremely wisely in order to maintain, you know, good dialogue and communication with the deputy minister. The public consultation role, and I wonder if anyone here must have, I guess not. The public consultation role, not only to relay and explain government policies, but to receive feedback from the public that would hopefully inform the policy development process, was supported by a consultative group of NGOs nominated by the disarmament ambassador as well as through a variety of public speaking engagements, especially at high schools and universities. And one of the innovations that I was proud of that we did during my time was that rather than having these big, just having a big gathering in Ottawa, we developed regional meetings of the consultative group. Again, this is something that, you know, sort of an insider comment in a sense, those in bureaucracies might smile at this. The position that I had was a roving ambassador position. It was a position that wasn't designed actually for career a diplomat. It was because of this kind of public diplomacy role, which wasn't usual at the time for foreign affairs. And of course, roving ambassadors weren't the norm. When I wasn't in Ottawa, I was on the road, living in hotels. So being in Ottawa was very good for the policy input side, but I had to be in New York and Geneva, and then I had to do these various consultations. When I wasn't in Ottawa, I was on the road, living in hotels with no cook, no chauffeur. And even when I was in New York and I would be there for say 7 weeks at a time, I would be in an apartment hotel. I was the most cost-effective of the ambassadors by far. And I say that because it was verified by an external audit near the end of my term. And this possibly might be the reason why other career foreign service officers were not clamoring for my job so much as seeking to change the terms of reference. Oh dear, I never said that. I've spent a bit of time on the terms of reference for this position in part. I mean, I think they really are interesting and they show, you know, they show a commitment, it seems to me, to trying to get, to get good policy. And also, of course, to dialogue with the public and for the government to get its views out on what it thinks the right policy is. I've spent a good deal of time on these terms of reference, not only because I believe they were good ones, but in part because they stand in such sharp contrast to the policies of the current government against meaningful civil society engagement in so many areas of public policy. I mean, I'm involved. You mentioned Peacebuild. I'm involved in a number of non-governmental organizations, and there is not a dialogue. I mean, you can send your views in and so on, but there's not a dialogue. Not to mention the gag order, the subject of much press commentary and various demonstrations, at least in the science community, on most official interactions with the public in the media. So, those were the terms of reference when I came in, and they envisioned a lot of time on the road in Canada. But the Berlin Wall fell very early in my tenure. November 89, I was appointed the end of August 1989, and that opened a whole new area of activity for me when I was not in New York or Geneva. Suddenly, with the ending of the Cold War, the UN could start to focus much more productively on regional security issues and conflicts, and I became involved in the UN-led regional security dialogue process for the Asia Pacific, the focal point of which was a sort of virtual UN peace and disarmament office in Kathmandu, Nepal. It was actually located in Nepal because, you know, the big guys were kind of, what do we want the UN meddling here for in these issues? The big guys, I'm thinking in particular of India. And if India was opposed, then Pakistan was opposed too. They agreed on some things. But Nepal was at that time quite active on arms. It hadn't yet had all of the problems that it subsequently had with its own internal security challenges, and they had long been a champion of UN disarmament. So it was an exciting time as we began to realize the retooling that we needed to do. Functional disarmament experts working in global multilateral bodies like the UN needed to gain regional expertise and vice versa. And so I began at least once, if not twice a year, to Nepal, and then a whole series of dialogue in East Asia and Southeast Asia dialogues. with the end of the paralysis in Security Council, because this was, of course, the huge, huge, one of the huge effects of the end of the Cold War, was the with the end of the paralysis of the in the Security Council, the UN could begin to think much more deeply about how to assist in resolving conflicts and how to build a sustainable peace post-conflict in what became bigger and bigger and more complex and multifaceted peacekeeping operations. And the early big ones, Namibia, Cambodia, Angola, Mozambique. So with the East and West no longer at loggerheads, the Security Council could look at a potentially productive role for the UN in helping resolve regional conflicts. In 1990, I was at a conference in Dalhousie University in Halifax, Nova Scotia, where both I and Gwyn Dyer were speakers. And I know Gwyn Dyer was one of your recent lecturers here. To the surprise, and I have to say dismay, of many peace activists there, both of us were very positive about the collective action authorized by the UN Security Council against Iraq following its invasion of Kuwait. So this is way back. This is 1990. This is the, you know, the first Gulf war, although war is probably not, you know, first, well, we'll leave it at that. We were encouraged, this is Gwyn Dyer and I, not because the use of force had been authorized per se, but because it signaled the ability of the UN Security Council to act together in a substantive way in the face of naked aggression. This was Iraq invading Kuwait, no doubt about it. And after all other measures, I know there's a debate about this, but there was a significant period of time in which all the measures in the UN handbook, the UN charter, about what you do short of using force, all the non-coercive measures were tried, and then the coercive measure of sanctions, very punitive sanctions, had been tried. Not the cutoff of all communications. It was interesting. Even then, the commercial ramifications of trying to interfere with international communications were such that that was not one of the sanctions that was levied on Iraq, even though it probably would have been it would have been a pretty effective one, but it wasn't because of the broader ramifications. So there was a period of time, efforts over and over, withdraw from Kuwait, and these, you know, there will not be further action. The U.S. had to be convinced, and here Canada helped, that UN Security Council authorization was essential for the broad international support and legitimacy that any action, collective action of this kind must have. And so Canada was, and this was E. Forche working very, very hard as our ambassador to convince the United States that they absolutely had to work within the UN system for this to have broad support and legitimacy. And if they wanted a broad coalition that would involve Arab nations, that it clearly was abroad. It wasn't a Western action. It was a genuine international action. And again, Canada played American diplomat, career diplomat, Ambassador Pickering, who also internally made the arguments as well in the US, but Canada was very important in this, in arguing that this broad international support and legitimacy that would be brought by the US working through the UN outweighed the danger that conservative Republicans saw from their perspective of setting a terrible precedent that would enmesh the US and limit their ability to act in future without UN cover. So it's interesting that way back then, they could see that a precedent was being set. Alas, a precedent that ultimately was broken. I might note at this point, since we're talking about the first Gulf War, it's worth reflecting on the way it ended So the UN Security Council authorized a coalition force led by the United States, Coalition of the Willing, to use all necessary means to get Iraq out of Kuwait. They moved forward into Iraq to do that. But President Bush Sr. did not exceed that mandate to oust Iraq from Kuwait. Once they did that, once they succeeded, these forces did not continue on to Baghdad to topple Saddam. There was great speculation in the media, oh, they're on the run, because Iraqi forces essentially collapsed in the face of the onslaught. And, oh, you know, they can get rid of this guy, this massive troublemaker. He'd been a friend earlier, but he'd gone off the tracks. Bush Sr. wrote in his memoirs, does anybody know, is anybody familiar with this, his memoirs, and Bush Sr.'s memoirs? He writes very clearly why he did not go further. Because, of course, the weight of sort of the U.S., you know, juggernaut, the U.S. establishment, the U.S. hawks were just clamoring, go right through and get rid of this guy. Just this incredible momentum. Why he didn't do it? He didn't do it, as he said in his memoirs, he didn't do it for two reasons. First of all, he feared that the Arab members of the coalition, so crucial for its legitimacy, would desert the coalition, and therefore the coalition would lose its legitimacy. And he feared, and he writes about using these words, that the action of going forth and toppling Saddam could destabilize both Iraq and the region with unforeseeable but likely profoundly negative consequences. Alas, that was not the lesson that George Bush Jr. learned from that. He saw it as this terribly missed opportunity that, you know, he was going to have an opportunity to do something about. But it's eerie reading what Bush Sr. foresaw as the consequences of, you know, militarily ousting a government. And then what do you have? Instead of military action to topple Saddam Hussein, a containment and disarmament policy under UN auspices was hammered out, and with which Iraq agreed as part of the terms of the ceasefire, and which were then given legal effect in Security Council Resolution 687. The disarmament by the UN Special Commission, so there was actually a body, experts were brought in from all over, from many, many different countries, a multilateral expert body called the UN Special Commission, and to deal with the non-nuclear side of the disarmament, and the International Atomic Energy Agency worked spectacularly well. So this internationally created, UN-led mechanism worked spectacularly well, with many-fold more weapons destroyed by these UN bodies than by the coalition forces. I used to know the numbers, but I don't remember the numbers now. But the economy and the middle class in Iraq were crippled by overly broad economic sanctions that were not lifted long after the overwhelming majority believed they should have been. And little attention was paid to the human rights aspects of the ceasefire agreement set out in Resolution 687. And I'll come back to that later when we get into the context of the second Gulf War, the actual illegal invasion of Iraq, as opposed to the first one, which was a UN-authorized collective action. Now I want to go back to the early 1990s and the impact of the Cold War. So I've been talking about how one of the big impacts of the end of the Cold War was to allow the Security Council to work effectively together for the first time to address significant security challenges, that first big one being ending Iraqi aggression against Kuwait. Going back to the work of the first committee of the General Assembly, and I mentioned how this is a deliberative body, so it sort of has a recommendation power. It's open to all UN member states. Resolutions are passed. It mandates expert studies, builds consensus for action, as I said earlier, such as negotiations, for example, on a comprehensive test ban treaty, which again was something that was ultimately was able to take place. But as I said, the actual treaty negotiations take place elsewhere. Now, in the first committee, and this had been taking place from when I first started there, and October of 1989, a number of developing countries, led by Colombia, had been trying without success for some time to get broader support for a resolution addressing the scourge of small arms and light weapons proliferation. The focus all during the Cold War was what mattered to the big guys. That had been, you know, the East and West facing off weapons of mass destruction, nuclear, chemical, biological, and major conventional weapons, you know, the massive main battle tanks and other major conventional weapons possessed by the Warsaw Pact and NATO. But a much more immediate issue for many developing countries was the proliferation of small arms and light weapons. So everything sort of below tanks that were fueling internal conflicts and crime alike. Of course, the most ubiquitous of the small arms and light weapons is the Kalashnikov, the military assault rifle. Take the case of Mali, a country that had long been plagued by one military coup after another, but which had finally managed to make the transition to civilian elected government under President Kanare in 1992. And I have to say, and I'll describe a little bit of the involvement I've had with Mali in its first, you know, and if its first move out of military dictatorships, and now seeing the problems that that they're in now, it's heartbreaking. It's a combination of, you know, governance not getting to where it needed to be, but also overflow from the war on terror and the massive amounts of weapons available to disaffected groups. But back to the happier phase. So they'd made the transition to a civilian government, and they had a very, very able president. President Kanare, understood that the ongoing problems of the Tuareg rebellion in the north, Arab Tuaregs in the north, were being fueled by small arms proliferation. And he turned to the UN Department of Disarmament Affairs for help. The then Under Secretary General for Disarmament Affairs, Yasushi Akashi, briefed the first committee about the organization's intentions to send the first ever departmental fact-finding interdepartmental fact-finding mission to Mali and the sub-region to examine the problem in context with representatives from the relevant geographic divisions and from the Department of Political Affairs, as well as from the Department of Disarmament Affairs. As a then member of the UN Secretary General's Advisory Board on Disarmament, I was honored and excited to be asked to participate. I have to say that many of my Western colleagues in the First Committee gave a very cold reception to the news of this mission. Some wondered whether the UN as an organization was overstepping its bounds, despite the fact that this action was at the express request of the government of a member state. I've given a lot of thought to why they reacted this way. Recall, this was the first ever, as I said, interdepartmental fact-finding mission. And perhaps some of my colleagues were worried about sharing their disarmament turf, which had existed for so long during the Cold War in splendid isolation, you know, from these real on-the-ground problems. My participation in the mission was focused on two activities. First, a conference in Bamako, which sought to engage all sectors of civil society on components of a new code of civil military conduct as part of the effort to build better relations between the Malian people and their military. And second, a visit to the camp 200 kilometers outside Bamako for the integration of Tuareg rebels into the regular Malian military. So very early form of what became known as disarmament, demobilization, and reintegration, trying to get the former Tuareg rebels, some of them at least, into the regular Malian military. The conference I found incredibly impressive, a real testament to President Konaré's determination to fully consult with the people of Mali. Meetings were chaired by high-ranking ministers, foreign minister, defense, parliamentarians were present, workers' organizations, women's groups, veterans' organizations, and many, many Malian military officers, as well as some others from the region. The Chinese had built the conference center. Of course, it was gigantic and way too big, and the Malians could only afford to provide air conditioning to the main plenary room, which probably was quite brilliant in the end because it meant there wasn't a lot of wandering away from the sessions when they were taking place. But what really got to me was that meetings went on. I mean, they started early in the morning and they went on until late at night. They literally did not end until every person in this vast room from whatever organization who wanted to speak had an opportunity to do so. I was exhausted and humbled. I also have another sort of vivid memory of the debate and the promise at that time, which I'm forecasting I'm going to get into the pernicious effects of the war on terror a bit, but the sort of contrast between what I saw there and then what has come later. As part of the deliberations on the new code of conduct, a sub-working group of serving Malian military, and I participated in this, considered the requirements of international humanitarian law for soldiers. Heated discussion honed in on the key issue, the right and indeed the duty of every soldier to refuse to obey manifestly illegal orders under international humanitarian law, such as the deliberate targeting of civilians. So this tremendous debate where, you know, a junior officer is saying, oh, I've got the right to do this, and the senior officer is saying, this is going to be disciplinary chaos and back and forth, but getting to the heart of that obligation under international humanitarian law. You seem along, you know, an obvious, I mean, one of the, okay, what's an example of an order they should, a manifestly illegal order? It would be an order to deliberately target civilians, for example. So we're a long way from that. Now, here you see, this is where I'm getting into the cutting and pasting. After the week-long conference came a four-hour dusty bus ride to the integration camp in a bus donated by the Japanese. Now, the Chinese conference building was gigantic. The Japanese bus was not. The seats were very narrow and certainly unsuitable for some rather sizable African generals. Luckily, I got to sit next to a fairly diminutive Canadian colonel. So I was okay. We were invited to view the graduation ceremony the next morning, which was to begin with a marching band and parade. The only place suitable for marching was the public road outside the camp, and it was market day, so the vendors and public alike heading to the market had to wait in the hot sun for over an hour while the diplomats were out there and the parade took place, the military marching up and down the graduating class. All of which to say that despite the promising beginning and the best of intentions, it was clear that the Mali military still had some ways to go in understanding what was required to build good civil military relations. And I actually have a picture. I'm sort of looking up at my sister here because I had a picture on the wall at home for a long time. Of people waiting, you know, of a cart and a woman in a colorful dress and the cart loaded with the stuff to go to market, you know, waiting to get to go by, oh, very patiently and very quietly. And I only noticed a long time later that underneath the cart, in the shade, was a little dog. So he knew where to be in those circumstances. I want to say a word about the outcome of the Mali fact-finding mission. The conclusion that that arms proliferation was a symptom, not a root cause of instability. The real problem was the alienation and economic stagnation faced by the Northern Tuareg, as well as the lack of any real government presence, especially in security terms. Therefore, any efforts to address the arms proliferation problem had to recognize and address the complex nature of the problem with both socioeconomic and security, or lack of security, drivers, bearing in mind that a minimum level of security was needed to do anything at all. For those of you familiar with the concept of human security, which subsequently developed during this time period in, you know, as opposed to state security, this Mali report was one of the early elaborations. To put this another way, it was the beginning of a recognition that there can be no security without development, but that for development to take place, there must be a minimum level of physical security. Just before I got into this discussion about Mali, I mentioned how uninterested major Western powers were in allowing, you know, in having the first committee focus on control of small arms and light weapons. I'm very happy to say that Canada was not in this boat. We are one of the very early supporters of Colombian efforts. To the literally scoffing dismissal of some of my Western colleagues, you know, small arms control. How can you control small arms? All of this changed in the wake of the revelations following Operation Desert Storm. That's what I was talking about earlier, the first Gulf War, the UN-authorized coalition action against Iraq in the wake of its invasion of Kuwait. All of that changed in the wake of the revelations following Operation Desert Storm on the scope of Iraq's arms buildup. Not just chemical and biological weapons, and significant progress towards a nuclear weapons capability, but conventional weapons, large-scale conventional weapons, missiles, tanks, fighter jets. And here's the important point. What came out was the role that the permanent five of the UN Security Council had played in that Iraqi conventional arms buildup, pumping obscene amounts of conventional weapons into that country, an arms bazaar. There was a whole legal regime in place to not allow the transfer of nuclear weapons or biological weapons. But lax export controls allowed, this wasn't country-led, it was a range of private companies to traffic in prohibited components for weapons of mass destruction. But we're focusing on conventional weapons. And in the wake of the successful action, Operation Desert Storm, suddenly there's all of this reporting, there's the international inspectors are in there, and of course they're doing a tracing, seeing where all this stuff came from, and suddenly there's a huge focus on the role that the Permanent Five had played in arming Iraq. I use the term Permanent Five. Are people here familiar with that term? Everybody's nodding. They, of course, are the five members of the Security Council that don't have to get elected every 2 years. They have a permanent role, a permanent place, and they also, of course, along with that permanent place, have the right to veto So nothing happens in the UN Security Council if one or more of the five United States, China, France, UK, Russia veto. In the glare of world media scrutiny, the American and UK policies were hastily reviewed and reversed. The about-face of the British government was so rapid that the UK disarmament ambassador literally had to amend his position during a first committee meeting. That is, in the morning, he spoke about the Colombian resolution calling, well, let me just back up for a second, because of course there's been all of this focus on everything that's gone on in Iraq. There's triumph at the successful result and the bad guy Iraq has been vanquished, and then suddenly the accounting is coming out and we're finding out all the money that these that the major powers had made selling arms to Iraq. So they want to get back, you know, they want to get back on track. So the British disarmament ambassador in the morning spoke against the Colombian resolution calling for action to control the spread of small arms and light weapons. And in the afternoon, he retracted the statement and spoke in favor of the resolution. The United States followed suit. This in turn led to an important UN expert study on the control of small arms and light weapons. So it's interesting to note, of course, the weapons in Iraq were major weapon systems. That's not what was going on in the first committee. They were trying, the developing countries, as I said, were trying to get a focus on small arms and light weapons, which were also relevant, but they weren't sort of the big ticket items. It's just that this was part of an effort by, in all the disarmament fora and in the glare of public scrutiny, for these governments to demonstrate that they were on the right side of disarmament and arms control. And because it was also a little bit of, you can argue, diversion. They didn't want controls on the big stuff, so they wanted to make a lot of noise about getting controls on the little stuff. Now that was fine, I mean, for many developing countries, it was the so-called little stuff that was killing them. They didn't have the big major weapon systems, so they would take this cooperation. So even if it was for cynical purposes, initially by the big guys, it wasn't a very, very important opening. And so that meant that with the support for the Colombian resolution, the next step was to get an expert, a UN expert study, which tries to look at the issue and build consensus on specific recommendations for action. Some of you here will know this name. So the UN expert study, typically it is national experts, government officials, diplomats and government officials with particular expertise that would be named to this body. In this case, in Canada's case, this was on the recommendation of Foreign Affairs, of Joe Clark, in conjunction with some very good people in the department. The proposal, the person that was proposed and accepted to sit in to represent Canada on this expert study was Ernie Regeer, a founder, one of the founders of the very well-known and very important non-governmental organization Project Plowshares, which, you know, has worked on all sorts of conflict resolution and peace-building issues, but has always been had a strong focus on conventional arms control. Ernie's an Order of Canada recipient now and a friend and colleague of mine. As I said, he was the Canadian expert on that group, the first time a non-official had been named by the Government of Canada to fill such a role. The study was the first of several and ultimately led to a UN conference in 2001 to develop an action plan to combat the spread of these weapons. I was an advisor, so at this point, by the time this UN program, so when we move ahead, as I said, this UN conference is in 2001, so that's, you know, where this issue ended up. I wasn't, my term as ambassador ended at the end of 1994, and I had done work outside the department, but for this process, I was asked to be an advisor to Foreign Affairs on small arms issues, and I was also appointed by the UN to chair another expert study in the lead up to the conference. This one was looking at the problem of arms brokers, those who arranged the deals, the arms deals, but did not take actual possession of the goods themselves, and thus were able to get around the arms export regulations of many Western countries. They found a loophole. Our export controls follow the goods and don't follow the brokers. The first meeting of the expert study took place while Bill Clinton was still president. But the second meeting was after President Bush Jr. took over. They had a decidedly pro-National Rifle Association, NRA, stance, and this was made plain to me when Tom Mason, no relation, the NRA representative shadowing every aspect of the UN activity on small arms, brackets, headlines, the UN is going to take our guns away and then invade us with black helicopters, phoned me at home. I mean, literally, we had those. When you went to these meetings, you had to go through crowds with signs that said this. So, after the change in government, before the second meeting, I got a phone call at home from Tom Mason, telling me not to worry, that they had talked to the White House and had made it clear that they were happy with the US expert on the brokering study and would not insist on any change. The message was absolutely clear. We have the ear of the White House, and the US will not agree to anything we don't want. The upshot of all this was a far weaker expert report, and then UN plan of action than might have been, particularly with respect to military-style assault rifles, the terminology, which on a technicality were considered civilian. You know, there were slight adjustments to an M16 or a Kalashnikov, and that somehow turned it into a non-military assault rifle, which everyone on the expert study and actually in the conference, the UN conference, everyone but, say, three countries, one of which was the United States, wanted to limit to the military and the police. So we couldn't get even that agreement that military assault rifles should be limited to the military or the police. The UN 2001 Program of Action Against the Proliferation of and Illicit Trafficking in Small Arms and Light Weapons was a modest but important step toward finally bringing some measure of control to the arms trade. Because, of course, once you start doing it at one level, then obviously the ground is laid for the other levels. Thanks, and now we really do have a bigger, much bigger step forward. You know, the work continued. Thanks, and many of you will be familiar with this, thanks in very, very large measure to the dedication of a vast array of non-governmental organizations across the world. Project Plowshares in Canada, Oxfam, Care Canada, Care International, the whole list, the International Red Cross, countless others. In 2013, a treaty regulating the arms trade. I mean, it's amazing, isn't it? Everything else is regulated up the yin-yang, but it took till 2013 to get a treaty regulating the arms trade. I mean, it's a long way to go. It's a first step. Of course, the enforcement is not, well, the enforcement is more or less up to each individual state, but it's a very, very important first step. However, it's with regret, it's with extraordinary regret and shame that I stand before you to tell you that Canada has not signed this treaty, which even the United States has signed. And you know the problems they have in that country with getting any kind of arms control. But President Obama was able to stand up and say, this doesn't have anything to do with domestic ownership of guns. This is regulation of the international trade. And was able to sign it without, he was able to do it. But, I mean, that is always an issue. But the importance of him signing it is that they're bound by it. In other words, the understanding is that if you sign it, then you're going to abide by the spirit and the letter. Of course, it's better to have it ratified because then you get all the legislation in place. That's a big issue. But you sure can't get it ratified if you don't sign it. And so, you know, it's extraordinary. If you think of the role, you look at what I went back and I talked about the kind of role that Canada played in getting this issue on the agenda and in getting non-governmental organizations, which have been a critical role in moving this thing forward. And now we're not signing we haven't signed it. Pardon me? Because our version of the NRA, which is sort of actually, they receive training, and I mean, it's a sad group, but nonetheless, because they say they don't like it. They don't like it. It's as simple as that. The Canadian delegation had a representative on it of the gun lobby in Canada, and they sort of mimic what the Americans say, and they say, you know, there shouldn't be any. This is the first step. It's a slippery slope. After this, they'll come to take your guns, and then it's the black helicopters. So it's ludicrous, but they carry the weight. And in fact, one of our senior related issue, one of our senior diplomats, senior negotiators, has resigned over, you know, positions Canada's taken, wasn't on this particular case. It was on cluster munitions. That's a whole other story. But, you know, we've gone from being leaders in pushing these issues forward to apologists, well, not just laggards, because if Canada doesn't sign it, then all sorts of countries can take cover behind us. It's the precedent that we're setting is. So, my interest in how the UN can help countries resolve conflicts and build a sustainable peace began with this focus on small arms. What the then Secretary General Boutros-Ghali in 1995 would call the weapons that are actually killing people in the conflicts with which the UN is dealing. For the weapons cannot be considered in isolation of the rebels or government forces wielding them. If ex-combatants are unemployed, they will return to fighting, or if the war is over, turn to criminality. I mean, there was an extraordinary example of, I think it might have been El Salvador, where the conflict was more or less contained in certain areas. But then at the end of the war, when there wasn't proper disarmament, demobilization, and reintegration, you had more generalized armed criminality. So for many people, they were more insecure. Retraining is meaningless without jobs in a functioning economy. Because what we're talking about is disarmament, demobilization, and reintegration. Reintegration is usually into civilian life. To do that, you need retraining so you can get a job. But you've got to have a functioning economy to do that. We're talking about a post-conflict situation. And you need fair opportunity for different societal groups to get these jobs, which in turn requires representative government, pluralistic institutions, and so and on it goes. This ultimately led me to work with the Canadian Centre for International Peace and Security, a non-governmental organization that actually had started out in 1983 as the Canadian Centre for Arms Control and Disarmament, but then again in the post-Cold War, reflecting this broader focus, became the Canadian Centre for International Peace and Security. So it led me, this is after I left Foreign Affairs, to work with this think tank and the UN Department of Peacekeeping Operations, a unit within the UN Department of Peacekeeping Operations. It was then called the Lessons Learned Unit. It's now the Best Practices Unit, but then it was the Lessons Learned Unit. I guess it's a better name because the lessons don't ever seem to be learned, or maybe they're learned, but they're never applied. But anyway, it's now called the Best Practices Unit. So I worked with them and a retired Ghanaian general, Emmanuel Erskine, who was quite famous in UN peacekeeping terms and ultimately, subsequently, became a politician in Ghana. I worked with those organizations and with him to develop the first ever UN guidelines. So principles and guidelines for the planning and implementation of comprehensive disarmament, demobilization, and reintegration of ex-combatants. In order to complete this task, we did field missions in Guatemala, Mali, Sierra Leone, and Haiti, and desk research in virtually every other UN mission where they had a disarmament component. Actually, as an aside, and I just happened to say, well, I'd left foreign affairs at the end of 1994. Interestingly enough, I the first 4 years it was under the Progressive Conservative government. Then the fifth year it was under the Liberal government. And it was actually at the behest of the department that the term was ended, because the terms of reference were changed to make it into a career diplomat position located in Geneva. I quipped at the time, based on the independent audit, 1/10 the coverage for 10 times the cost, because gone, of course, was the roving ambassador aspect. As a result of which, as a former ambassador, I continued to do a lot of the UN regional dialogue at the request of the UN. So back to doing this Principles and Guidelines on Disarmament, Demobilization, and Reintegration. The most important lesson that we learned in this process was that to get this right, to get this aspect, this one element of post-conflict peace building, disarmament of former fighters, demobilization of them, I mean, some of them will stay in the military, in a unified military, but most of them want to go home and have a civilian life, and then reintegration into civilian life. To get that right, you have to get the whole thing right. I talked earlier about you have to have a functioning economy, you have to have democratic institutions so there's a fair shot at the job. So in fact, that little piece, to get that right, you have to have the bigger political framework right. You need a comprehensive peace settlement addressing all relevant issues underlying the conflict and effective methods for implementing the agreement once achieved. Now I'm looking around here to see where I go next. I talked earlier about the promise that Gwyn Dyer and I saw of a more effective UN Security Council in addressing challenges to international peace and security in the wake of the actions taken against Iraq in 1990-91, the first Gulf War. I also noted that to fulfill this promise, the Security Council actions had to have the broad support of at least a majority of the international community represented by the General Assembly. During the time that unity held, that broad support held, one can say it was the heyday of modern UN peacekeeping, very complex operations, bringing countries, one that really stands out is Mozambique, out of very long, difficult conflicts and helping them transition to a democracy, helping them build, helping former rebel forces learn how to be politicians, how to run a campaign, and how to fight an election, and how to accept the result. So really, those glorious days. Over time, however, any hope of maintaining this broad-based support and legitimacy for Security Council action, for an activist, really in a positive sense, activist Security Council action, was frittered away for a variety of reasons. This loss of Security Council legitimacy in the eyes of the broader UN community probably began with the American fiasco in Somalia, when a Black Hawk helicopter pilot was captured and dragged through the streets of Mogadishu, and of course they made a film out of it. To his shame, the UN was blamed publicly. The UN peacekeeping mission in Somalia at the time was blamed publicly by President Clinton for this fiasco, but really, and I know this because I know I was briefed on the private military assessment done by the Pentagon after, by those who were really unhappy with the way the blame was being attributed. It was really a colossal failure in communication between two different US military special forces operating in Somalia outside the UN mission. Harken back to my comment about how in these kinds of contexts you better have your lines of authority very, very clear. The reason why this is important is that this fiasco led the US to block authorization by the UN Security Council of a strengthened UN peacekeeping force in Rwanda, just as the genocide was beginning to unfold. And of course, this is another one where Kofi Annan wears the blame, but the blame is elsewhere. And I was in New York at the time. And of course, there isn't an actual vote veto by the US. The way they do it is behind closed doors, they tell the other permanent five, there's no use putting this on the table because we will block it. So in the club, they don't want to embarrass each other, they don't put it on the table. I mean, sometimes they want to embarrass each other, but at that time they didn't, and therefore. So there was no public blocking, but in fact that's what happened. So just as Canada's own General Dallaire was begging for reinforcements, Security Council wasn't authorizing a beefing up of the force. It seems that the USA, this is now on my part speculation, but I think it's fair speculation. It seems that the US burned in Somalia, no longer wished to engage, I mean a lot has been written about this too, in the quagmire of African peacekeeping. But like a dog in the manger, they didn't want to let anyone else play either. Or more to the point, they didn't want anyone else succeeding without their leadership. Yes, one of the advantages of being a retired ambassador is that I do not have to be diplomatic now. But I do this for a reason, because we see echoes of this mentality, although happier, not being listened to, we see echoes of this mentality in the Republican attacks on President Obama for not leading in Libya, for example, or Syria. But clearly, the president sees the need for international action, at least some of the time, even when the United States is not in a position to lead, or he understands that sometimes it's better that the United States is not in the lead. But the most important reason by far for the loss of broad support, I mean, I'm going through all this because it's important to understand why that great promise of the UN system wasn't, at least in the security area, because they do many, many good things in other areas, wasn't met. By far the most, and it's this breakdown of cohesion and support. It's the breakdown of the broader community standing behind the Security Council. And it's interesting because they can't be effective without that. And the most important reason by far for the loss of broad support for an activist UN Security Council was the US refusal to lift the exceedingly punitive economic sanctions against Iraq that I mentioned earlier, which caused such immense suffering among ordinary Iraqis. When the sanctions were levied, there was no time limit put on them. And what that meant was any of the P5 could veto the lifting of the sanctions. And this is what the US administration did. And there's so much back channel stuff on this and domestic American politics on it. They insisted on maintaining the sanctions long after all their allies, all the rest of the permanent five in the Security Council, the rest of the Security Council, the rest of the Western allies wanted to end them. Not only because of the damage they were doing to the Iraqi economy and the Iraqi middle class, but also because there was a fully developed long-term monitoring system developed by UN Special Commission and the IAEA ready to go to focus on what really mattered, sensitive military and related technologies and weapons. This intransigence gradually poisoned the atmosphere for collaborative action between developed and developing countries at the UN. USA non-payment of dues, and this was a congressional thing. USA non-payment of UN dues, courtesy of the arch-conservative Senator Jesse Helms and his henchmen, doomed much-needed UN reforms in relation to clearing out the political deadwood that had clogged up the UN as a result of long years of Cold War dumping. So you've got, you know, this poisoned atmosphere, and you've got the fact that the UN is having difficulty retooling itself in the way that it needs to, because it's got this massive amount of political debt. I mean, that was one of the games that was played during the Cold War. Each side, you know, east-west, got the big guys got a certain number of positions, and then they brought their people in, and you had this massive amount of deadwood. And that leads me to a story of the new hires at the UN in the early 1990s, and they all had to be hired on contract because of the budget situation. There was enough money to hire them on short-term contracts. This was new blood eager to help the UN retool for the complex regional conflict resolution efforts. One of them was the former Canadian military advisor to the Canadian diplomatic mission to the UN in New York, Colonel Douglas Fraser, the one who was sitting next to me and not taking up too much room in that bus in Mali. And he was the point person for arms control and disarmament on my delegation. He was asked, once he went into the UN system, he was asked by the UN to be the secretary to the Mali and sub-regional small arms mission. And he was the lead pen of the groundbreaking report that I talked about. Although, of course, all the public credit went to the distinguished ambassadors and other luminaries on the delegation. In order to pay for this desperately needed new blood, other than for this very short period of time when they were brought in on contract, the UN had to buy out the deadwood. You know, the classic, I mean, this is what you have to do, had to buy them out. And an American expert, a very good American expert, was brought in to UN Human Resources, to head UN Human Resources, to develop a plan to do so. And he did. But, and they had the money to do it, but the money presupposed that the big contributors to the UN system, because it's a formula based on role in the economy of the country and size and so on, but the failure of the US to pay its annual dues meant that there was no money to complete the plan. And there isn't a doubt in my mind that this was consciously done. The American administration, smarting from the fact that the UN had been successful with respect to Iraq, not the American administration, the American right, really wanted to make sure that the UN wasn't going to continue to develop, become more competent. And so, with no money to keep many of the promising new hires on board, they had to be let go. And I was told that certain staff in the office of the UN Secretary General were literally in tears when Colonel Fraser and others like him cleared out their offices and left the building, because they could see, you know, what they were losing. Back to the frittering away of all that promise that Gwen Dyer and I celebrated at the end of the Cold War. It turns out, of course, that starting wars is a lot easier than ending them. The UN was sidelined in the peacemaking efforts to end the war in the former Yugoslavia because it was believed to be the European moment when they could take care of their own problems. Equally serious, there was no real consensus among Security Council members, even Western Security Council members, on what needed to be done. So, they authorized a UN protection force, UNPROFOR, UN protection force, with disastrous results. This is a huge issue to discuss, but I'm bringing it up now because what I want to emphasize is that insofar as UN peacekeeping was concerned, and this really matters till this day, entirely the wrong lessons were drawn by many Western countries, Canada included, for the so-called failure of UNPROFOR in former Yugoslavia, in contrast to the success of the NATO, the subsequent NATO-led NATO-led military stabilization missions. The first one was called I-4, NATO Implementation Force. Second one, S-4, NATO Stabilization Force. The important point is that UNPROFOR, a small, relatively light blue helmet force, was deployed in the middle of a war with a mandate to deliver, or to help, to facilitate, to help the humanitarian community to get humanitarian assistance to those desperately in need. There were supposed to be safe corridors that they could bring them through, but it was all agreed. It was on the basis, the agreement of all the parties, that this lightly armed UN mission would try and help get humanitarian assistance to those desperately in need. While the diplomats tried, without success to negotiate a treaty. And largely, I mean, there were tremendous problems with UNPROFOR because they became a pawn. I mean, they became a pawn of the parties, notably the Serbs in the conflict. But they did manage, in spite of all of that difficulty, to fulfill their core mandate, which was to bring humanitarian assistance to those desperately in need, and they, it was believed they saved upwards of 200,000 people doing that. The contrast with NATO is that not only did NATO forces deploy in much greater numbers with extraordinarily large arsenals of weapons, but, and this is the important point, they deployed in the context of a peace agreement. They didn't deploy in the context of a war. So the really significant point, I mean, of course it was helpful that they were very well armed, but the really important point was, it still wouldn't have been a good thing if they had to go to war with all the parties. But they deployed in the context of a peace agreement. I mean, albeit one that was forced down the throat of Milosevic and with many flaws which bedevil the region to this day, but nonetheless in the context of a peace agreement. And it's also very worthwhile to remember that significant and underplayed factor in that capitulation by Milosevic was the huge peaceful protests against him, which were going on at the time of these negotiations. Okay, boy, I'm going on too long here. I'm going to have to, I always go on too long, but anyway, that is very, very relevant. That lesson, that learning, because that became the excuse. I mean, it's one thing for the Americans to say, we don't want to be under UN umbrella, blue helmet umbrella, as long as all the other Western forces were under the umbrella, then the Americans can provide equipment and so on, that's fine. But as a result of the horror, I mean, from the basic military perspective, I mean, the Canadian soldiers that participated in UNPROFOR, it was a nightmare. Because if your job is to facilitate humanitarian assistance and you see terrible things going on over there that you can't do anything about, I mean, it's horrific. But the trouble is that that became the sort of raison d'etre for most Western forces to then say, okay, we're not going to do UN peacekeeping. I mean, that became this sort of excuse for them not to do it, and that continues to this day, with the notable exception of the French, who have stayed in with incredibly important results and incredibly important understanding of what has been what is required. Because the trouble with leaving is that the Canadian knowledge of UN peacekeeping is this old, very narrow UNPROFOR style idea, as opposed to true multidimensional peacekeeping forces with a political mandate and all kinds of tools to help move the country out of conflict and into peace. So, in other words, exactly what wasn't done in Afghanistan. And I believe that had our forces and other Western forces had a better, had stayed in UN peacekeeping, had gone through all of the incredible lessons learned through all of the various missions that have continued on, despite the lack of professional forces, they would not have so easily followed the American lead in the disastrous way that Afghanistan. I mean, Afghanistan, I can't, you know, I can spend a whole, I can spend, it is, you know, it is the, every lesson that the UN learned, you know, painfully on what not to do, NATO, which didn't need to know anything from the UN, repeated with disastrous effects in Afghanistan. Okay, so I've talked about, and I'll just very, 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 I mean, because we got to have some, we got to have some time for discussion. I definitely cannot estimate my time. I just want to touch on very, very briefly now. So we've talked about the Great Promise, and then it was frittered away. And then, against that backdrop, I want to now turn, because we have to sort of bring it up to the point of where we are now, to September 11th, 2001, and the utterly disastrous course we have been following since that day. If we ever are to build peace in the 21st century, we have to get onto a different track, and fast, a track that enlarges common ground and lays the foundation for meaningful collective action. And really that means the UN front and center, to resolve regional and global governance challenges. There are so many pernicious aspects to the American-led international response, but let me highlight the worst. First, the US contention that everything has changed. And people still repeat that, almost like just rote. By which they meant that the international rules of the road enshrined in the UN Charter and in international treaties and in customary international law, for example, in relation to the treatment of combatants, and even the fundamental basis for our democracies, the rule of law, no longer applied. What a testament to the strength of Western democratic values that we abandon all the preaching we've done to developing countries in difficult circumstances to hold to these principles. But the minute we faced our first serious challenge, oh, these rules are no good, out the window they go. But possibly as bad as that, President George Bush Jr.'s dictum, you are with us or against us. Nirvana for the extremists. I remember listening to CBC that day when that speech was made and hearing a commentary from Pakistan. We are doomed, the analyst said. There is nowhere now for the moderates to go. Rather than isolating the true extremists, doesn't that strike you as maybe the strategy that might be better? Rather than isolating the true extremists, conflate your enemy to the maximum extent possible. That is still going on. This is something, one, that you don't hear. I mean, this is really insidious. Loss of the notion of the legitimate security concerns of each state. This is part of the UN Charter's basic ground rules. Security concerns of some, namely privileged Western countries, trump all others. The axis of evil, remember them, and anyone who supports them do not have legitimate security concerns. They are entirely illegitimate. And the fourth of these, and possibly the most insidious, loss of the concept of negotiated settlements as the key to finding sustainable, enduring solutions to conflicts. And I mean meaningful negotiated settlements, not sort of backroom deals to save, the biggest warlords. This is another bedrock principle of the UN Charter. The loss of this concept, September 11 world, derives in part from the idea that you can't negotiate with evil, and it is buttressed by its proponents, the hawks, extraordinarily naive belief in the face of everyday evidence to the contrary of the efficacy of force to solve what are essentially political problems. Of course, the use of force does have one very, very effective result. And what's that? Follow the money. Makes a lot of money for certain people. But in terms of the efficacy to solve what are essentially political problems, it's a very blunt instrument. It's ironic to me that the warmongers are often seen as the realists in this context. This also, of course, ties in with the downplaying and disparaging of rule of law solutions, which would have meant privileging enhanced international efforts to legally apprehend and prosecute alleged terrorists instead of walking into bin Laden's trap of endless jihad, where we obligingly allow all local grievances to be turned into a battle between the locals and foreign conquerors. And the final point that I'll make on this is that this loss of the concept of negotiated settlements, it's not just a view that you can't negotiate with evil and that you have to be tough. It's also the architecture of the war on terror has put practical roadblocks to negotiating comprehensive settlements. Non-governmental, or the terrorist blacklists, in many cases, prohibit direct engagement. Canada stands alone in having put, and even recently, like after, in the last year, I guess they did it, all of the Taliban on the terrorist list, Canada's anti-terrorist list, all of the Taliban. And the result of that is that I, as a member of Pathways to Peace, I'm a member of the International Steering Committee of an organization that works with a whole bunch of Afghan organizations, I have to be extremely careful about promoting a comprehensive peace process, because direct contact, Canada prohibits direct contact with listed terrorists, and they interpret that to mean your people. So in other words, within our umbrella, it's not just me having the contact, it's my counterparts in Afghanistan. And there's also serious restrictions on funding. So for example, no American funding is possible now because the Americans have such restrictions. So not only is the concept of a negotiated settlement being, you know, delegitimized, well, it's delegitimized by these kinds of methods, but it's often, this curtailing of the role of NGOs is extremely problematic, because often for governments it's difficult to make those contacts, and in fact they may not be well received for all sorts of reasons, and NGOs have played a very important role here. So I have got to stop. I want to say that we have to get on a different track. And one of the things that I was going to talk about was groupthink, and I had a bunch of examples of groupthink, because that's a very handy mechanism. You take off the table as unreasonable all of the options that might actually work. They're seen as naive, negotiating. How can you negotiate with these guys? Naive. And the groupthink is a very powerful tool within government and outside in the media. And that means that there's a special responsibility for those who maybe were inside and are now outside to try and break through that, and to try and speak on that, and to try and call for a return to these, the fundamentals, if you will, of conflict resolution and peace building in the 21st century. Thank you very, very much. You've been very attentive while I've...